Okay, let's come back to together. Let's come back together. So Bob Perlew is coming to your town, and you have to make the biggest publicity splash you can so that it can benefit you and your club. How are you going to do it? What's the first thing that you're going to do? Let's start back there and kind of work across here. Let's start back there. First thing. Right behind you.
I know, because he is coming to our area.
Oh, good.
On Saturday, the 24th of September, he's coming to Northern Delaware. So we are putting this together, or at least our district governor is.
Okay.
And what I would do, if I were in the position, is have a packet put together of information about the international president, his picture, a little bio, why he's coming to this particular area, something about Lions International, Lions Club, you know, why he chose this particular place to make his bus stop in our area for an hour and a half, and, you know, the playground that this one of our clubs built using grants from LCI. And sort of go into, have a little packet together.
Okay, so what I'm going to summarize then is that your priority would be to make sure that the media had a packet so that they'd understand who he is and why he's coming here.
Correct.
Okay, good. Another thought? Maybe in the middle there? And then there's one up here. Keep going like this, and then he'll come.
I'm John Bingham from 1182 in Michigan, and Bob is going to be visiting our area in Detroit the 29th. A lot of people don't know, but Detroit helped charter Windsor, Ontario, which is directly across the river. So he's going to be doing an international visit, both with the USA and Canada at that time. So we're trying to promote it on both sides of the river to have as many people, the media, the mayor, any politicians.
Sorry.
We're trying to find some politicians that are actually Lion members to come also.
Okay.
And then again, it's been sent out statewide also.
Okay.
So we're trying to blast as much information out there to the media, you know, try to get interest. And, you know, come and meet our international president, and there's other individuals who are actually putting this together.
Okay, so if I could summarize, then one of your priorities might be to stress the international nature of this visit, because here is not only history from the starting of the first Canadian club to make it an international organization, but it's the international president, and it's all of this. So your objective or your goal might be to make sure the media understands how big this is.
Right.
Okay.
In both countries.
Good. In both countries. Great. Okay. Up here, I promised the screaming hand. The screaming hand. Yes. My favorite kind of student.
Yeah. Screaming
hand. Right
there.
Lion Paul Newton from MD9, Iowa. He's coming to Iowa Sunday. He's going through the whole state. Yes. And what we're doing is we're going to hit every media outlet we can think of, from social media, newspaper, radio, TV, anything. Since this is the centennial bus tour, as he's calling it, and it's 100 years, it's a pretty big deal for our organization. And that's what we're doing. He's stopping 3 places in Iowa, even a campus club down in Mount Pleasant. And he's having a dinner at ours, and we're going to try to get local media there to run a speech and see what he's all about.
Okay, so here you have a statewide effort, and you're involving the campus. So one of your goals might be to show that this is a broad organization that's not just a community, but it's also in campuses and young people. That might be your objective. One more, and then we're going to move on. Somebody who has, there's a screaming hand in the back. This is, you know, PR, you have to make yourself be persistent.
Hi, my name's Darlene from Reno, Nevada. Bob Corlew is not coming to us. So this is what we would do. Well, first we would do is get a picture of him actually doing community service, not just his, you know, picture, but actually doing something. And also we would talk about why he's visiting our community and explain what the Lions Club is all about and Lions International, because a lot of people don't know who Lions are. We are the best kept secret in the world. And so if there's a disaster in the area, that might be a good way of promoting him. Or if there's a service project we're working on that he's involved in, to promote that.
And that's really great. So the idea then is promoting actual service and developing stories. Your goal would be, we want to make sure we get some really great content so that people understand what we do.
Right, okay. Because they see us, but they don't know okay. Who we are.
Thank you. I wish we had time for everybody, and there'll be another chance for us to do some talking, hopefully at the end. But what I want to suggest is you have some really great instincts, but I want to remind you of some of the training that you've already had. Because we need to, whenever we go to do any kind of public relations, we have to go through a process where we establish our goals. What do we want to accomplish? Okay, Bob Corlew is coming. What is our goal? We're not going to get everything because, remember, we're just spam. So what is our goal? What is our specific goal with our meet? And how much money do we have? I mean, if we're doing this on just a shoestring, we might only be able to use social media. If we have some funding where we can actually make some press packets and put some material together, you'd need to have a budget for that. These are club things. Planning ahead, obviously, he's coming next week, so you've been planning. But that would be something you have to think. What do we have to do to establish that relationship with the local media so they understand how significant this is? And what is our timeline? Who's in charge of different things? Who's going to make sure this gets written? If we're doing a press release, who's writing it? How soon does that have? Usually press releases have to be to an outlet at least a week in advance so that the media has an opportunity to determine if they want to cover it more than what you've provided. They may bring a reporter up. Yes?
When you do your press releases and stuff, is it better to do it like maybe a month or two in advance, just like give a warning and then keep doing the press releases as it gets closer?
Actually, that is a very good question. The question was, is it good to give them notice a month in advance and then give them information closer? It depends on if it's spam or not, because if you can give them the information that somebody's coming, that they may want to have it on their radar, you could let them know that. But I wouldn't send them a press release a month in advance because it'll go into the garbage. It'll get lost in the inbox. And really, 1 week, if you're giving them enough time, 1 week in advance tells it's newsworthy. And if you establish a relationship and you have an ongoing relationship so they know, like, here's something that's happening, you certainly could tell them that. But I think when you send material, if you do it more than a week in advance, we're in an instant age. I mean, I could type it up right now and send it right now, and somebody could pick it up and it's on Google. So it really, that advance time was in the olden age. Yes?
Keep it simple.
Yes, keep it simple. That's also correct. Remember, they only have so much space, they only have so much interest, so keep it simple. So the other thing is, though, I talked about the screaming hand. The idea is we need to be persistent. If you think something is important, you will keep in contact with your person that you've established the relationship with at the media. You won't just keep sending emails to them so that they know what's going on, because they will be putting that away. So how do you pitch the media? What is the strategy? This is something specific that's a skill that I think it takes a little while to acquire, but it's certainly worth the effort. What I would suggest is if you are trying to work with the local media, target one reporter at a time. Find the person that you think is most likely to be receptive to stories about Lions. And then find out all you can about that person. Find out the background so that you can tailor your information. If I know somebody's interested in social causes, or if I know somebody is supporting like environmental issues, then I can say, well, did you know that Lions also have an environmental awareness program and that we're planting trees? Now suddenly that reporter who's interested in the environment goes, ah, I've got a connection with Lions. Those kinds of finding out about that reporter, doing some homework, especially with the bigger papers, will often get you in the door. And you need to help the media understand the big picture, this person that you're speaking to. I mean, talking about the international president coming to Detroit and Windsor, where the first international Lions club in Windsor was formed, and the United States was the first area, and Canada was the second. You know, constitutional areas are terms that mean something to Lions. That doesn't mean anything to media. We're the United States and Canada, this is the first international club. Here's the big picture, the president is coming. Another way that you can pitch your media message is to explain how this relates to the public. You know, you're building a playground so that the public can come to it. You're providing large print books to a library so children who are blind or visually impaired can use that facility. Find a way to get the community benefit. These are ways that the media will be more attracted to your story. Another strategy is don't ever send it as an attachment, because I don't know about you, but I get attachments all the time, and my university tells me never open an attachment from someone you don't know, because it probably has some kind of a virus or it's going to get into your computer. So if you send, here's a link, that's not going to work. They're not going to open it. But if you type the message out fully in the body of the email, they will read that. And that's where you need to be making all the references you can to follow up, make sure that they got the email that you sent or got the message that you sent. And you need to keep going to them, because they're not going to come to you. It's a two-way street. We want them to come to us for information, but we're going to have to be persistent. And we're going to be persistent when we give our epic content. And that is the way you're going to make the local media more interested in what you have to say, is if you tell stories that reach people in their hearts. Talking about activities that enhance a community. I mean, you're going to get coverage when your Lions Club is helping to provide disaster relief to a flood or a tornado or a fire or a hurricane. Your club will get recognition if you are explaining, Lions are giving disaster relief grants, where they're helping to clean up. Those are stories that the media will pick up on. When you have holiday projects or special fundraising events, sometimes the media will pick up on those as a fluff piece, you know, because they need things at holiday time. So think about what your community does at certain times of the year so that it may be a special interest story. Not news, but something that they can write as soft news. Obviously, things that provide a community service, speaking to somebody who has received glasses, someone who has been affected by had a scholarship or received an implant or something that where they've benefited directly from Lions, getting their story in is important. So you've gotten their attention, how do you keep their attention? Obviously, you need to be providing them news all the time, but you can't be talking about your club activities as they relate to members. You need to talk about your club activities as they relate to the community, because they're not interested in club news. And that's what your newsletter is for, your club newsletter. You put everything in that you want your club members to know. That's a different kind of PR. Your external PR has to be directed at the public, and you need to constantly be looking at how are we serving a unique group of people. What is the interesting piece of information that we're sharing? It may be that you're bringing in a speaker who comes in from the outside and is going to give a public presentation. You know, sometimes we bring in our speakers and we only have them talk to Lions. Wouldn't it be a great opportunity for us to create like a press conference or an opportunity for them to speak to the public or arrange for them? And sometimes our executive officers will do that when they come. But usually, we're always very focused on ourselves. We always look inside, and we need to be promoting our people, our activities. We need to constantly be keeping the information going to the person that we have established conflict or contact with. So now my last think exercise is I'd like you to think about some examples of your most successful public relation efforts. Something that really went well. Anybody have one that they'd share? Yes.
I have one. After the Joplin tornado, I contacted Lamar Signs and told them about what the Lions had done in Joplin. And they were so impressed with the heartfelt work that the Lions have been doing and were continuing to do. The money that we had for a PR campaign, they probably quadrupled the money. And we had billboards for 6 months, three that rotated the entire path of the tornado with a big Lion logo on it. And most of it was because they provided and gave it to us. So that was fantastic.
The idea or the information about the Joplin tornado and how a local firm then, because they got the impact of the Lions, they put up billboards for an extended period of time. And so making that relationship really paid off. Yes, over there.
I got a full page article about my leader funding just because I was in near where the newspaper was and they saw me walk by.
And that happened because you made a contact with the editor, or the editor saw you and your activity. And those relationships are the key to increasing your success with the local media. Any other example? Here's one over here. There's one there, and then we'll come over here. There's one there, and then we'll come over to the side.
I just had for this past weekend the front page, full page in the newspaper. We had our concession trailer stolen, ransacked, half destroyed. And in February, that was in the newspaper. And a follow-up to that, I built a relationship with one of the reporters. He came and took action. He wanted an action shot, me working on the trailer. And that's exactly what he got. I gave him all the information. And at the same time, this came out when we had a giant car show with 2,500 cars. The center of the community was all barricaded off. We're showing these things, and this is the article in the paper, which is distributed to everybody. Front page, and it's all Lions, a Lions emblem. What more can we ask for?
Well, that's terrific. And you know, the idea from something bad that happened, from the crime, you took advantage to show through, you know, we can overcome. And you establish the relationship, and then they come out. If you establish a relationship with the media, you find that one person. That is really the best advice I can give you in terms of working with people. Yes.
Robert, kind of to exemplify what you're talking about completely, I am sure someone from this forum contacted the Omaha World Herald to have an article put in to promote the forum. There's no article in the Omaha World Herald because although we think we're mighty, it's not that important. Monday night at our club meeting, the president of our club his friends and brought in the editor of the Omaha World Herald as our guest speaker. At that event, we talked to him and said, did you know that coming in to Omaha this week are Lions, and this is what we're doing? And then we talked about the project I'm in charge of tomorrow with the kids and the screening and our service and the meals. Immediately when he got home or back to the office the next day, someone contacted two people of our club to promote the forum because they made it worthwhile for what Omaha readers wanted to see about Omaha kids being able to come down and be screened. About, we brought up the fact that Wilsner Pilger got a $10,000 grant from International, making it local, and we were in the paper yesterday.
You are giving a total reinforcement also to our message from last night. Our speaker from last night, who said, lead with mission, not with meeting. If you make your news the mission of what we're doing and how we're reaching, then the news media, if you establish that relationship, they'll respond to it because they want to know about the mission. They just don't want all the news about our meetings, our organizations, our structures. That's a piece of it that then they can say, well, if we explain all of that to the public, then they're going to think we need to do it for all the organizations. But when we are the leading service organization and our mission is to help children, to feed the hungry, to give vision to people without sight, to save the environment, that mission is what the media will publicize. Mm-hmm. And if we establish that relationship, all the examples that you were talking about are really stories about what Lions do. And that's why the media covers them. Yes, sir.
I'm going to put in a plug for Guiding Lion program. I don't know if we have any Guiding Lions in here, but awesome. It's an incredible program. It's not difficult. It's on the LCI website. It makes great bathroom reading. And one of the things that they talked about in there was promoting the brand. And so when I was president of our Lions Club, we don't have many of our Lions Club members that go out into our community and wear Lions Club apparel. So I had a shirt printed that said Owensville Lions on it, and I put the names of our members on the back that had done something notorious for the year, and put a number on the back of their uniform, and gave that to them as the president's award. For the work that they had done in the year, rather than giving them a gift certificate to Walmart, which had been our present, which had been the tactic that we'd used for a long time. And now we see Lions all over Owensville wearing their t-shirts that say Owensville Lions on them.
That's great. You know, that's what we often will do with campus clubs too. We'll get them Lions shirts to wear because that's good PR on the campus. Right. So if you have campus clubs as districts to help them to do PR. There are lots of ways to do PR. But the big strategy that, of course, I've been trying to suggest this morning is we don't want to forget the basics. There are basic things. We need to use the websites available. We need to be passing out brochures. We need to be displaying the logo, wearing t-shirts. We need to be putting things into packets so that people know about it. We need to be inviting the editor to our meetings so that we can then let them know what's going on. We need to display our peace posters in public places so people walk by and see them. And what's this? And then you get promotion about our activities and how we're helping youth. You know, sometimes school newsletters will send out information about Lions if it affects students. Putting highway signs out in your community. These are the basics. These are the things that we always do. But when you really are working with the local media, there are some nuggets to remember. And that would be accurate in what you present. Don't give them incorrect information because they'll never trust you again. Be on time because newspapers and media operate on deadlines. They have to have it at a certain time. If they don't have it, they won't put it in there. And remember, then it's old news, so you wasted all your time. Be ethical. Don't try to represent things in ways that aren't true. And make sure that you are putting a positive image, just like anything else. You know, we can have disputes and squabbles in our club, but that shouldn't be the news. The news should be our positive mission of what we're doing in the community. Remember, news media are like birds. They won't come back if you forget to feed them. So you have to keep reminding the person that you're contacted with that you are the PR chair and you're going to be giving information. One of the things I always do is I always communicate with when I've been a public relations officer for our club and for our district, multiple district. And when I would do things, I would always contact the people that I thought were the sources of where I was going to put the information, and introducing myself. Hi, I'm Robert Littlefield. I'm the PR chair for Fargo Lions Club, and I'm the one that will be providing you the information from time to time. Who should I be sending that to? And can I get an appointment to visit with that person? I always make the personal connection, because that way I make sure I'm not spam. I get to the spot where I want to be. Keep a record of what you do as a PR chair. One of the things that is a big issue is you might do a lot of work and then you're done with that job and you put it all away and the next person comes in and they've never done it before. It's really helpful for a PR person in a club, for example, to have a calendar of what you did. Like when we had our big fundraiser, I always did this a month in advance. I contacted the media. Keep a record of what you do to help the next person, because it is hard to reinvent the wheel. And sometimes, I know when I was first learning to do PR, I would keep samples of what I had done so that I would kind of model what I was doing on those samples. It makes it a lot easier. And then always thank your media contacts. You know, we send them a note. Thanks a lot for the coverage. That was really a great article. I appreciated that picture. You know, we give Melvin Jones fellows out to people who are supportive. What if you get a really, like your editor, who suddenly realizes this is a significant thing? So let's give our editor, let's give somebody in the community a Melvin Jones fellow. What does that mean? That means that we regard you as a person of respect, that you've done something to promote goodwill among people of the world. Find a way to give something back to your media from time to time. You know, it's not a bribe, it's simply a thank you, and it's an appropriate way for us to show our respect. I wanted to make sure I left some time for questions, and so we have about 10 minutes left. In this presentation today, I have tried to revisit some of the basics of public relations and identify the players and the rules of the game and some of the things that we need to do. And I hope I provided you with a few strategies or a focus, a different way of looking at media, not just as that entity like TV or that anonymous source, but as people, relationships, because we've heard your success stories. The most successful PR projects you've had come when you've established a relationship with someone. And that's the job that we need to ask every person in the club. Yes?
Question. If you are going to be outgoing public relations, you know who your incoming is going to be. Would you take that person to meet your contact?
Yes. If you are the outgoing, the question was, if you're the outgoing PR person and you've got a new person coming in, do you help to bring them along and meet the media contacts? And I would definitely say yes, because you want the continuity. And you might have established this great relationship, and if that person just keeps coming to, you know, if the next person goes to that person, you've got the same relationship. And I think that's an important way. And you can also then give some information to your new person. This reporter really likes environmental projects, or this person is really interested in youth-related projects. So anything you do, try to focus on those. You can help it both ways, both helping to get your person in, but also giving your new person feedback about that person that you're going to be working with. Yes?
I'm from a major area, Denver, Colorado. Yeah.
Here's a mic.
Oh.
I'm from that major area, Denver, Colorado, so it's a big metropolitan area. We have, you know, we're the lead club in the area, but we also have a number of smaller clubs in the metro area. And I'm trying to figure out, we have basically one newspaper. How do you sort through the maze of a major newspaper to get to the right people?
You know, that is, I was in Fargo. Now, Fargo isn't as big as Denver, it's different than Denver, but it's the same kind of thing. How do you work through the different levels? And what I would do, first of all, is make an appointment as the representative from your club to contact the editor first and just say, I'm the representative from my Lions Club, and I'd like to speak to someone about I want to make a contact so that I can submit some information. Can you direct me to the right person? The editor, if they are open enough, usually most editors won't want to be perceived as unfriendly, or they'll at least refer you to the right person, or there might be an assistant to the editor. You have to get to whoever will talk to you, but ask, our kind of story typically is human interest story, things that are about projects or the things that we're doing in the community or the public. So it might be you want to know the education editor, because anything related with youth, you want to talk to that person. You may want to talk, who's the sports editor, Special Olympics. It could be something that if your club isn't, it depends on what your club does, but you could find what your specialty projects are and find out who the person is who is the editor or the lead person in that section. There are usually a business section, and there's usually kind of a general variety section of information. There's an entertainment section so that if you're sponsoring a program. So you just have to look at what kind of activity are you interested in promoting, and then try to get to that level of the paper and make contact. And then what I would do is, honestly, my secret was I would always call the copy desk and say, I have a press release to be sending in. Who's on the copy desk tonight? And they'd say, well, it's Dave. And I'd say, what's Dave's email address? And then they'd give me his email address, and then I'd mail Dave the copy. And I always got the information in the paper, because then Dave thought, here's a story coming right to me. And, you know, I would... you just have to find the way to get in, but usually you can be pretty straightforward. Go to the level of the sections of your paper and find the right one.
And that's a personal contact.
I would make a personal contact. I would probably call first and say, and then I try to schedule an appointment, and then I would come in and talk to the person. Yes. I think we have time for three more questions.
Good morning. In our area, print newspaper has all but disappeared. So what would you suggest in that case?
Well, you know, one of the things that I think people are getting more and more interested in blogs, and it's very easy to start a blog. And you could start a blog, somebody in your club could start a blog on a website, and then you could post that blog on Facebook every time you put a new entry in, and once you're on Facebook, people start liking it, and they start coming to your blog because they want to read what you're writing about. And it may be your slant on things, mm-hmm. but the goal of PR is to get people to come to you for information. And if you are in a place where there's no newspapers, print newspapers, there are online papers and there are online newsletters and things like that. And so I would suggest working in that way. Yes?
Okay. Two-part. Negative PR situation.
Yes.
Our club was involved in a lawsuit, and we didn't really have any guidelines on how to handle something that took 8 years ago. We disagreed with
it. Oh, dear.
Negative. What advice do you have in terms of handling?
Well, this is what I would call crisis communication, and he asked a question, what do you do if you have something bad happen and you're trying to communicate about it? And what I would suggest, first of all, is you would put together a crisis team so that you would have only information coming from one person or a minimum of two people who are the official spokespeople who present the information. Because the last thing you want is five or six voices out there all giving their own interpretation that don't have the accurate information. Obviously, the very first thing to do would be to call, make sure LCI is helping you, because Lions Clubs International has a legal department and a public relations department, and they will help you to craft the messages that you need, and maybe you already did that. But one of the things that I found with local clubs when bad things happen to local clubs is everybody starts talking about it, and we're getting everybody's take on it, and not everybody is knowledgeable about it. So that's what I would say within your club, you should kind of create this plan of how you're going to communicate about it. And if anything's going to be said about this topic, Tom is going to say it, because he's the spokesperson for the group who's giving the information. He has the most complete information, and do it that way.
The other thing I would say also is that if you have events and have reporters coming in, our club has a strategy of handling the reporter. Nothing worse than they show up for a positive story and then the negative vanity in your club grabs them and parades them for half an hour about some inane item, and next time you invite them, they're not really keen to come back.
Yeah, that's right. You really need to control your own members and have that plan in place. So that would be my best strategy. One more question, right here. Yes, you.
Another great question. Two real quick things. One, if you send a photo to the paper, make sure you identify everybody in the photo. We've got feedback.
I need people in the photo, and I think with newspapers, if you're still using your local paper, they are struggling. It doesn't hurt to occasionally buy an ad, and that also will get you a contact mm-hmm. at the paper and a warm feeling.
Yes, and you know, advertising and public relations are two different things. They kind of fit together, but public relations is really about public relations. Advertising is really about paying for space. And you want to get as much as you can with the good relations. And so you are the ambassador for that. So I am so happy that you came this morning. I hope that you felt that this was useful to you in some way, and I'll be around for the rest of the forum. So if you have questions you want to talk, or if you want to paw, I'll be glad to paw with you anytime. And now back to Linda. Thank you, Linda, for moderating and assisting.
Thank you, Robert. Anybody who did not paw when they came in, since I understand it may not have gone right around the room, could you come and see me? Because then we know how many were here, and you'll get a copy of today's seminar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. Have a great rest of the day.